If you have had inconsistent spurts of motivation with regards to taking care of your health, your business, your relationships, where some months you are high energy, some months you are low energy and you don't want to restart, then this video is for you. Because in this episode of Get Real with Rajiv, I'm going to talk about the ABC of consistency. Apart from that, in this episode, I'm also going to talk about how do you handle the situation where your employees are leaving the workplace because they're finding it too hectic to work for very little results. I'm also going to answer a question in this episode of Get Real with Rajiv about what do you do when your organization is making a change in its structure and you are being asked to take a smaller role in the process. I'm also going to give you the answer to the question of how do you have wholesome conversations as a family and not just talk about business even within your family so that you have an enriching family life. If you would like answers to all these questions, then tune into episode number 81 of Get Real with Rajiv. Welcome to episode number 81 of Get Real with Rajiv. Like every single week, I'm going to be answering four questions, and today Pawan is going to be the voice of your questions. So Pawan, what's the first question?
We have Manasa asking, we are a fairly new company where me and my employees work as per client requirements. Since the clients are based in the US and we are in India, we end up working day and night. People in my organization are leaving because they think they're overworked for very meager results. What should I do to retain them?
Well, Mansa, let's break this down. Firstly, money is not the only solution to retail people. Please understand this. Your job as an organization is to pay people enough so that when people are coming to work, they are not thinking about the money, they are thinking about the work. So rule number one, pay people enough. The second thing that you need to do is you need to sit down with your team and you need to define what would a good quality of life mean for them, keeping in mind that the nature of business is such that you're serving clients in the US, so high probability is you're working in a night shift. So define with your team what would a good quality of life mean. So first you pay them enough, then you define what's a good quality of life. Because unless and until as a team, you don't define and you don't create clarity for everyone that, hey, this is a good quality of life. That if you're working from, let's just say, night shift of 10 p.m. India time to 6 or 7 a.m. India time. I don't know what that is. Define that and what's the kind of leave, what's the kind of leverage they get through the day. Otherwise, does work intrude into people's daytime as well after working in the nighttime? If those things are there, you need to iron it out. You can't expect people to work on a 24-hour shift. So define what's quality of life. Because sometimes I see lack of clarity of what quality of life means at a workplace. So people are always complaining. They know it's a night shift, but they're still complaining. Sit down and have that conversation and define what's a good quality of life and how the organization can support people in attaining that good quality of life, keeping in mind that the nature of work is such that you're serving clients in a night shift. So that's the second step that you need to do. The third thing that you mentioned in your question that caught my attention is that people are working hard for meager results. Now, I'd like to understand a little bit more about what you meant by meager results. By meager results, are you referring to their pay, an individual's pay scale? If it is, then go back to rule number one, pay them enough. But by meager results, if you are referring to your business results, where you feel the business is not making decent profits, for you to be able to empower your team members financially or from a career growth point of view, then it's your responsibility to look at that business model, evaluate its profitability, and adapt and create a business model that is profitable. So all that effort that you and your team are putting in is worth it for all of you. So these are the three things that I would recommend. Look at these three elements and drop me a message on Instagram and tell me how that conversation with your team went. Because what I sense out of your question is that there's lack of clarity. People are coming to work, but they don't really know what's the end goal, what's in it for them, how is the workplace taking care of their quality of life, and where are all of you headed together. So I think you need to have a few set of conversations, Mansa, for you to be able to bring everybody together and align everybody. Make sure you have these conversations and tell me how it went for you. With that, let's go to the second question for the week. So Pawan, what's the second question?
Gupreet is asking us, I've been working at a firm for 5 years in a particular role. Although my responsibilities have increased gradually, off late a new management that has come in is forcing me to take a step back and concentrate only on my core skills and let go of the certain responsibilities I've taken up. I feel like I'm stuck because I'm really indebted towards the CEO in the company for various reasons. What do you think I should do?
Well, Gurpreet, that's a very, very fair and a very, very interesting situation that you are in. Based on what you're saying, what I understand is for the last 5 years, you've been the man Friday for the company. You've been the man who stepped up and not had any boundaries. You've gone out of your comfort zone, taken whatever responsibilities that are available, filled all the gaps, and you've played the role of an intrapreneur, somebody who's been hands-on in the business and gone beyond their role document and done whatever it takes to contribute to the organization, which means that is amazing. That's a lot of credit to you for who you are. You're truly an asset to the organization. So I can understand that when this situation is happening, where a new management is coming in and they're trying to streamline roles and they're telling you stick to your core responsibilities or stick to your core skills and manage only those roles, you're feeling like it's a step back. So firstly, I want you to pat yourself on the back for feeling what you're feeling. This is what assets feel in an organization. Okay, so pat yourself on the back for that. Now, I can also understand that this may create a little bit of insecurity for you, because you are the sort of person who's done whatever it takes and today you've been put in a box and said, hey, this is your core skills, stick to this role and take a step back. So I know it can create a little bit of a doubt and it may feel like it's taking a few steps back. So I completely understand and empathize with your feelings and emotions at this point of time. I completely understand that you may probably feel that now you are made to feel a little lesser significant than how you are usually made to feel significant in the process. So those emotions that you're feeling are pretty valid. Having said that, here's what I'd like you to do. I'd like you to take a step back and view it from the point of view of the organization. What's happening within the organization? Why is your CEO bringing in a core management team? The intent that I see through is that the CEO wants to move the business from chaos to stability. So far in the chaos, it's been superheroes like you who've saved the day for the organization, where you've jumped into any and all responsibilities. But there may not be many superheroes like you within the business. And that's what has led to the CEO to think, hey, how do we move from this chaos to stability? And when an organization moves from chaos to stability, they often look at moving from a people-driven organization to a system-driven organization. And in such a scenario, what ends up happening is people like you, who are used to multitasking, who are used to playing diverse roles, who are used to stepping up whenever, wherever required, you feel constrained because now you've been told to stick to your core skills itself, which theoretically is not wrong, right? It's not wrong for an organization to align people's roles and say, hey, each one of you stick to your core skills itself. But I know it is creating some kind of an emotional setback for you. So here's what I'd like you to do, Gurpreet. I'd like you to do two things. Number one, ground your intention in what I call the principle of high performance. What is the principle of high performance? In any organization where people align to the priority of keeping the goal first, which is the organization's goals first, put people second, which is their team members second, and put themselves third. When people in an organization come with that common intention to put goals first, people second, which is each other second, and themselves third, that's the kind of organization that ends up becoming a high performance team. So ground yourself in the intention of goals first, people second, individual third, and think, is this alignment of roles, is this systematization of the business good for the company? If it is, put the goal first and understand the larger picture, understand the bigger picture. Now, having said, when you embrace goals first, people second, and individual third, then you embrace change with dignity. But let's just say you resist change out of personal insecurity, where you understand this is great for the company, but it's not the best for you because you've been doing everything everywhere and now you've been told, hey, stick to this role. When you resist that change, which is for the greater good of the organization, then you will end up losing the dignity that you have earned only because of your personal insecurities. And you don't want your personal insecurities to ruin the goodwill that you have built over the years with the organization. Okay, so understand the larger intention, ground yourself in the larger intention, and while you do that, also have a conversation with the CEO. I'm not asking you to be a dumb duck and accept whatever's coming your way, but have an authentic conversation with the CEO where you're sharing that it's not easy for you to let go. It's not easy for you to now go back to just operating based on your core skills because you worked on the business like an intrapreneur, like somebody who owns the business. and let the CEO know, reaffirm your commitment and say, hey, listen, I'm going to do this because of my love for you, because of my love and commitment for the company. Gurpreet, I promise you, if the person on the other side has a clean intent, they will see through your intent and you will earn the kind of respect that you would have never ever earned professionally in your career. So let him know about your insecurities, be authentic about your feelings and emotions, and be authentic about your commitment to the organization that you're willing to let go. And let him know that you're always there. You're always one step, one conversation away for you to step up in the game. And I wouldn't be surprised, Gurpreet, if you create this kind of a commitment or you affirm this kind of commitment with your CEO. I wouldn't be surprised tomorrow if this core management that has come into the picture, if they turn out to be transactional people who don't really care that much about the organization or the company because they've not grown with the organization and they demonstrate behaviors out of ego and personal dominance. I wouldn't be surprised if your CEO sees through those behaviors and will fall back upon someone like you to step up and be a part of the core management. Because at the end of the day, when you go to give with a clean intention, you get way more than you expect, provided the other person also has a clean intention. So you are at a little bit of a risk. If the other person is not having the same clean intent as you, then you may end up feeling used up. But just treat that as a lesson and move on in life. Probably look for another organization. But I think you need to give this organization an opportunity to stabilize by letting go, and also give this organization the opportunity to reaffirm your commitment to the CEO and let him know that you're always there, though this is not easy for you. So have these conversations, Gurpreet, at the end of the day, conversations expressed out of authenticity, find their way to people's heart, and if they have a clean heart, then you see magic that happens over there. So all the best for that conversation, Gurpreet. Let me know how that went for you. With that, let's move to the third question for this week. So Pawan, what's the third question?
Gokul says, I've always had spurts of motivation to be the best version of myself, be it weight reduction, be it my career growth, or be it being a good son, husband, or friend. It just fades away after a while. After a while, I'm left with no motivation to restart. What do I need to change to change this?
Well, Gokul, firstly, what I'd like you to do is turn on the microscope of awareness on yourself and make a list of all the triggers that kill your motivation. Let me explain this through an example, like a simple illustration. Let's just say you're motivated to work out, lose weight, get fit. You start hitting the gym, start working out. You do it consistently, let's just say for 2 months, 3 months. And after 2-3 months of consistent effort in the gym, you get on the weighing scale and you see nothing much has changed. Now, is that a trigger? When you don't get the desired result in a particular area, is that a trigger? If it is, make a list of it as a part of the triggers that kill your motivation to be consistent. Let's just say in a relationship, you want to provide, you want to be there for your family, you want to give. But in the process, while you are providing, you are spending quality time, you are being there for people. Sometimes in conversations, you have arguments, and then those arguments become a trigger for you saying, why the hell am I putting so much effort? Then put that down. That when I'm not getting the reciprocation that I'm expecting, then that's becoming a trigger. So, Gokul, the key is to identify what's the point where you lose that motivation, where you lose that consistency. Firstly, identify those triggers in every area of your life, be it with your business, be it with your health, be it in your relationships. Identify the triggers. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a common pattern. And I'll tell you one common pattern that I see that people fall into is they stop being consistent when they don't get the response or the reciprocation or the result that they expect. And usually, those expectations are the ones who kill their consistency. Consider this, my friend. Whatever changes you're making in your health, in your business, in your relationships, don't do it for a result. Do it till you get a result. And there's a very big difference between these two approaches. It's almost, I have seen people who go to the gym for 2 weeks or 2 months and they expect miracles to happen. They may not change their way of eating. They may not change their sleep cycles. They may not change their water intake. They may just work out. And for them, because I'm putting the effort in workout, now I deserve that fit and flat body. It's an amalgamation of so many elements. Now you've got your workout on track, then you get your sleep on track, then you get your water intake on track, then you get your food intake on track. You get everything on track and you keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it, trusting the process. That's when you start seeing results. Because I'll tell you, for some people, when they demonstrate motivation and change, they become like, you know, little puppies who want that treat. As long as you're giving the biscuit, the puppy is giving you the shake hand, the puppy is standing on two legs, the puppy is doing a round and round for you, the puppy is rolling for you. The moment you stop giving the biscuit, the puppy is not listening to the command. Your brain becomes like that. You want that biscuit, you want that result, saying, oh, see, it's working. Hold on, my friend. Do it for the process, not for the result. In your business, in your relationships, in your health, whatever you're doing it, do it because that's the way you want to live life. That's what you want to create as your lifestyle, not just for the result. And in the process, keep searching, what else do I need to change? What else do I need to add till I get the result? So there's a big difference between people who play for the result versus people who play till they get the result. That's the first shift you need to make. And I want to give you something to think about. I call them the ABC of consistency. What do I mean by the ABC of consistency? Firstly, in every area of your life, for you to make consistent change, you need accountability. That's the A of the ABC. So get a coach. Get somebody who can play the role of an accountability partner. Somebody you will surrender to. Don't just tell a friend saying, okay, Macha, you hold me accountable. And then tomorrow the friend tells you, wake up in the morning and you're like, today let me sleep. No. Find somebody who you genuinely will respect, somebody you will surrender to. You need a coach, you need an accountability partner in every area of your life. That's the A of consistency. The B of consistency is balance, which means what? Don't overdo things in your life. Okay, maintain the equilibrium, maintain the balance. Be it when you're making changes in your health, make sure that your family is in line with that. Let's just say you say, oh, I want to only go on a high protein diet. And let's just say your spouse is the one who manages the home and she's got to cook separately for you. And now she's got to cook based on the demands of your parents. And then she's got to cook based on the demands of your children. Then please understand that your pursuit of balance is throwing her life off balance. So create balance for yourself and the people in your life. How do you do that? Probably get a cook. Get a help. That's what it's going to take. You don't want your wife to be stuck to the kitchen and just doing everything for everybody and being tired and exhausted at the end of the day. Then your diet is meaningless because it's exhausting her, right? So you need to, whatever changes you make, even in your business, check for balance. What impact will it have on my team? What impact will it have on my client? And how can I take everybody along with me when I'm making these changes? So that when you take everybody along, then it becomes easier to stay consistent. That's why I say A for accountability for consistency, B for balance for consistency, and C stands for clarity. So you need accountability, balance, and clarity to remain consistent for any change in your life. What do I mean by clarity? You need to have clarity in terms of the right approach or the strategy or the system to follow, be it in your health, be it in your business, be it in your relationship. You need to have clarity of the right system and you need to have the capability to implement that system. So constantly enhance your clarity. I always say this to people, version one is better than version none. Try something new, see how it's working, see what's working, what's not working, retain what's working, change what's not working. Keep learning till you create that clear system and have the capability to live life as per that system. It's a pursuit, it's a journey, my friend. So enjoy the journey with ABC, accountability, balance, and clarity. I hope that makes sense for you to remain consistent in every area of your life and build the lifestyle that you would like to wake up to every single morning and say, hey, this is my ideal day. So all the best with that, Gokul. So with that, let's go to the fourth and final question for this week's episode. So Pawan, what's the fourth question?
The fourth question is from Ventesh. Being in a family business, all we do as a family, be it at work or at the dinner table or during an outing, is talk shop. I feel like there is no other thing that we can converse as a family about. This is really frustrating. How to go about changing this?
Well, Ventesh, I'm glad you bring this up because I think this is a common trait in many family businesses. That you at work, you're talking work. On the dinner table, you're talking work. At the living room, you're talking work. And at an outing also, you're talking work. Now, let me tell you, if you want to shift this, please understand, why are you talking work everywhere? You're talking work everywhere because You have goals at work. You have clarity of what needs to happen at work. That's why you're talking about work everywhere. So what do you need to do to change this? You need to create clarity of goals in every other area of your life as a family. You need to set goals as a family to live a holistic life. And this is where I say that as a family, every person needs to set health goals for every individual. You need to set wealth goals as a family. What kind of assets, what kind of savings, what kind of investment you want to build as a family. You need to set relationship goals as a family from the point of view of what are the rituals as a family, how many outings a week, what are the rituals at home so that that connection, that conversation level is sustained as a family. So you need to have relationship goals as a family. You need to define business goals as a family. Business is very different from your wealth. Business gives you the income, how you use that income, how you save and invest that income creates your wealth. So you need to have health goals, wealth goals, relationship goals, business goals as a family. You need to create recreation goals as a family. What are the things that you will do as a family? It could be outings, holidays, vacations, weekend getaways, engaging in sports together, any hobbies together, engaging everybody in some kind of recreation or activity. So you need to have recreation goals. You need to have contribution goals as a family. How do you want to come together and give back to those who are in need? You need to create contribution goals as a family, and you need to create spiritual goals as a family. How do you want each one of you to evolve spiritually? What do you need to learn? What do you need to experience? What do you need to explore to grow spiritually? Now, when you create goals in all these seven areas as a family, then you will see because you have goals, you have direction. Because you have direction, you have something else to have a conversation about. Today, you don't have anything else to have a conversation about apart from business, because that's the only area of your family life where all of you have clarity and you have direction. So set holistic goals as a family. And if you'd like to learn how to do this process, then here's what I would recommend. On my website, I have a product which is called an And Life Planner. It's a diary. It's a system that I use to plan seven areas of my life, which is my health, wealth, relationships, finance, my business, my recreation, my contribution, and my spiritual growth. And every person in my environment, my team, my family, every person uses that And Life Planner system. And we create goals together in every aspect of our life. And it's a very enriching system. So go on my website, grab a copy of the And Life Planner for every person on your family. And with every copy of the And Life Planner, you also get a free training from me on how do you set holistic goals as a family. So make sure you get that for yourself and for your family, Venkatesh. And I promise you it will be a very, very enriching experience, and it will be a game changer for you as a family. So enjoy living that holistic life then.